Your SpaceShip One. That's the first man-made aircraft to break the sound barrier. How cool is that? They have it here.
Yeah, it's my first one.
There's a whole bunch of info on it. That's cool.
It's only about 5 or 6 minutes. It's not long. Can you see it, or do you need to over here by the rail?
It's neat.
Oh.
And a video. You want to watch it?
All right.
Or do you want to go sit on the floor?
This is the time from takeoff in the white night to reaching altitude ready to launch the spaceship. It was a very difficult time for me. Mentally, sitting there with no one to talk to, and just your own soul. You can't help but help survive. I was ready, I was fully trained, I was trained up to the end of the earth, you know, all the simulated flight. You got a real short checklist right before you go, and you've got this whole hour. Nothing went wrong. I thought it was a very nerve-wracking, awful time. I didn't like it at all.
Mark, 3, 2, 1, mark.
From the time you're released, SpaceShipOne drops down and very abruptly into the flight of the weapon engine field. You immediately unload the switches that turn on the ignition and fire the rocket. And you do that as quickly as you can so that you can build up some speed. When that happens, you get this tremendous explosion. It's just literally unbelievable. It's going to be an explosion of energy behind you. It just slams you in the back and you're accelerating. At such a rate, you know, in 9 seconds you're supersonic, and you're controlling it with the hand stick, and you're trying to keep your wings low, trying to get the nose coming up. And there's a lot going on. That's the busiest time of the flight. After that, you can sort of sit back a little bit and relax and enjoy the ride. But that part of the ride is your brain is going 1,000 miles per hour. You're trying to think of everything you can think of to keep it straight. And very, very exciting time. Once you get your nose straight up, you're accelerating dramatically, you go through Mach 2 very quickly, then through Mach 3, and then you shut the motor down, and you have this complete silence, and you coast out of the atmosphere, and right in front of your eyes you watch a blue sky turn to a midnight black sky. And that was a tremendous thing for me. I just thought that was the most amazing thing I've ever seen in my life. In the middle of the day, the sky went completely black. Once you're out of the atmosphere, you start the feather coming out. It takes about 15 seconds for the feather to go all the way up and off. And then you're just coasting on and the sky gets blacker and blacker. And you can turn it and look down at the earth and see the incredible colors and textures of the earth. Then you reach apogee, you're at 0 degrees for 4 minutes. Anything that's loose in the cockpit, if you've got a pencil or a pen or a camera or something that's not tied down, it's going to be floating around. And it was a lot of fun because I wanted to be able to show my friends and family and other people really what it felt like. So the night before the first flight to space, first official flight to space, I stopped in at the AMP and flea market here in town and bought a bag of M&Ms. And I put them into my pocket on my shoulder here, in my flight suit. I completely forgot about that. I never told my wife, I never told Bert. I never told anybody that I was planning on releasing some of those because I knew they would immediately say no. I mean, it was just foolish to be very excited like that. So I didn't want to be turned down, so I did it anyway. And then when I got out there, I suddenly remembered that at apogee, when I was at the top, stopped, 0 airspeed, I pulled out my zip from my pocket, took out a handful of those, put them out in front of me, and they just kind of stayed there. It was such a weird feeling. Because if you do that here, they just fall on the ground. But up there, they stay right where you put them. So then I pushed them around the see what would happen. And then I threw out another handful of them when we went about my visit. The reentry is very exciting. Well, we bend the feather up, we bend the tail up 70 degrees to the fuselage. And so now, instead of it coming into the atmosphere nose down like the shuttle does, we bend the feather up. We re-enter with the fuselage and the wing flat to the atmosphere. So we have an enormous amount of drag. The wing, the fuselage, causes a lot of drag, slows it down very, very quickly at very high altitude. So we don't get the real high heat buildup that we would if we came in those coasts. And that was the key to the success of the whole program. It's a carefree re-entry method that Bert invented himself. And boy, I'm sure he was correct about that. It worked flawlessly. The noise as you come into the upper reaches of the atmosphere is really tremendous. I mean, there's a screaming gale sounding, a lot of wind noise. Now that we're in the atmosphere, the first thing you want to do is get the feather down, because you cannot land the plane in a feather condition. It would continue on down all the way to the ground if you did not feather. You need to get those two children all the way down and pop the trailer again. It's kind of an anxious time. You know, it feels like a lot more than 15 seconds as you watch the mechanism and watch the indicator telling you where it is. But you try to get it down as soon as you realize you're below supersonic speed. And at that point, for me, it was just a complete relief, because I knew that I could easily take it to the airport and land it. The landing procedures, once you're unfeathered, you fly back to the airport, you descend over the airport, and then you just make one turn and you're on the ground. There isn't any go-around, there's no auxiliary power, you can't restart the rocket motor. It is a dead stick landing, and it's entirely up to you to judge it, so that when you hit the ground, you're on the ground. You know, you're on short final, and in a couple of seconds you're on the ground. You realize you've done it okay, you're sitting there on the main tires, and you are excited because you've just achieved this incredible goal. And as it came to a stop, you know, I saw the trucks and cars pulling onto the runway behind me. It was absolutely exhilarating to see the reaction. And then the crowd went ballistic. And it was great because the crew chief drove the truck right next to the crowd line. And I was able to really feel like I was part of it. They were just, wow, this is fabulous. And I was here, I saw it happen.
He was over 61 miles up. That's far. That was interesting. I don't think I paid much attention like back when it happened. I don't really remember a lot. Cool.